ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد. Dear brothers and sisters, we begin by praising Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We seek the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we seek for His forgiveness. We rely solely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we have full trust and conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. For whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes to misguide, that person will never be guided. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes to guide, that person will never be misguided. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who are guided. Ameen. We send peace and blessings upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family, his companions, and all the pious predecessors. Ameen. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst them as well. Ameen. Dear brothers and sisters, all of us are aware that the month of Dhul Hijjah, the highlight of this month is the Eid that was done yesterday, the Eid al-Adha. And as we mentioned yesterday, that Eid al-Adha in reality is the celebration of the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam. We know that Ibrahim alayhi salam sacrificed his most precious item, which was his son. The thing he loved the most. He sacrificed it while he was willing to sacrifice, to be exact, for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this month revolves around the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And as many of us are aware that the title that was given to Ibrahim alayhi salam by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was Khalilullah. Khalil, which most of us can translate as a friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But in order to truly appreciate how close Ibrahim alayhi salam was to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in order for us to truly understand how great Ibrahim alayhi salam was, in order for us to truly understand how dear Ibrahim alayhi salam was to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have to understand the meaning of this word Al-Khalil. Many of us, as we mentioned, that we define it, we translate it as a friend. But in reality, the word Khalil has a much more deeper meaning than just a friend. In short, Khalil means someone who is very close to you, means someone who is very dear to you, means someone who is very beloved to you. And Khalil has been defined by the scholars of tafsir, that the word Khalil comes out from the root words of khalal, which means emptiness and gap. And they say the reason why khalil is related to that word, because as they say, the Arabic, the way they describe it, they define it, is that لِأَنَّ مَحَبَّتَهُ تَتَخَلَّلُ الْقَلْبِ فَلَا تَدَعْ فِيهِ خَلَلًا إِلَّا مَلَأَتُهُ. That khalil is such a close friend, is someone you love so much that his love permeates and penetrates into your heart to such an extent that it leaves no gap, it leaves no space empty except that his love fills it. That's the deep meaning of Khalil. So in other words, a Khalil is a person that you feel empty when you're not around that person. Khalil is a person that you're so close to that you miss them when you're not around them. Khalil is such a person that you long for, you want to always be with that person. And as we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beyond all these emotions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beyond all these feelings. Because feelings and emotions are a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beyond His creation. But in order to in order for us to understand how close, how beloved Ibrahim alayhi salam was to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is what we can use. That for us, Khalil is someone we miss. Someone that when we're not around that person, we want to be with that person all the time. That's how beloved Ibrahim alayhi salam was to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He had a very, very high rank. And this is how we understand it. But the question is, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took Ibrahim alayhi salam as a very close friend. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took Ibrahim alayhi salam as someone very beloved and dear to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the question is, how exactly did Ibrahim alayhi salam become so close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How did Ibrahim alayhi salam become so beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? At the end of the day, that's our goal in life. That's our primary objective in life. That how can we become beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How can you become close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And as we know from the previous khutbas, that the way to get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's only one way. And that way is following in the footsteps of the Anbiya alayhi salam. Following in the footsteps of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of all the prophets. And we know that Ibrahim alayhi salam was one of the greatest prophets throughout the history of mankind. So in other words, our objective in life is to follow in the footsteps of these great people, of these great Anbiya alayhim as-salam. And there were people, both men and women, who achieved this high rank, who achieved this greatness and this proximity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions them in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions both genders, both men and women. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about Maryam alayhi salam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the wife of Fir'aun. These were very high ranking women in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved them. Just like how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved the other Anbiya alayhi salam. So that's the question, that how do we become the Khalil of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How do we become beloved? How do we become dear to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And inshallah, in today's khutbah and in the upcoming khutbahs, what we'll be doing is we'll be examining a passage from Surah Al-Baqarah, whereby it speaks about Ibrahim alayhi salam. And inshallah, this will give us much more information and a greater understanding on how Ibrahim alayhi salam became the Khalil of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And inshallah, with that information, we too can become the Khalil of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah. So this passage in Surah Al-Baqarah starts from ayah 124. And the ayah begins as, وَإِذِ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ فَأَتَمَّهُمْ. A very superficial, a very rough translation of this ayah is, and recall the time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Ibrahim alayhi salam with a number of injunctions, commands, with a number of different afflictions. فَأَتَمَّهُنْ, and Ibrahim alayhi salam completed all these commandments. Ibrahim alayhi salam fulfilled all these obligations, and Ibrahim alayhi salam endured all these afflictions. That's a very superficial, very rough translation of this ayah. But in order to truly appreciate what this ayah, the message behind this ayah, we have to examine each word in this ayah. The first, the ayah begins, وَإِذِ بِتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ, that the exact translation of إِذِ بِتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ would be, his Rabb tested Ibrahim. And the word ابْتَلَى means affliction, something difficult, a hardship. And in the context of this ayah, it refers to a test. It's a test. Ibrahim alayhi salam was tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we'll get to exactly with what was he tested. But just stay with me as far as this part is concerned. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Ibrahim alayhi salam. What is the purpose of a test? The purpose of a test is to assess the aptitude or to assess the capability of someone or something. In other words, if the teacher gives you a test and you pass the test, then that test shows that you have the aptitude or you have the capability of going to the next grade. If you pass your road test, it means you know how to drive a car. But if you fail it, that means you need to go back and practice again. So a test is there to show us the results. But the question is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-alim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all-knowing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has full knowledge of everything. So why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala need to take this test of Ibrahim alayhi salam? Doesn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already know that Ibrahim alayhi salam is so loyal? Doesn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already know that Ibrahim alayhi salam is dedicated and committed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So what is the purpose of this test? Inshallah, if we understand this, then we will understand why we are faced with different tests on a daily basis. There are two reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts us through these tests. The first reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Ibrahim and why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us on a daily basis is number one, and if we understand this point and we accept this point, then we will see that every test in reality is a blessing for us. Just like when you go for a road test, you know whether you know how to drive or not. If you fail a road test, then you'll know that, okay, you know, I don't know how to drive, so for my own safety, I'm not going to get on the highway, because I'll either crash or kill somebody or kill myself. But if you're arrogant, you're going to say, you know, this guy was racist, or, you know, I'm a girl, that's why he didn't pass me, or whatever, right? And you're going to go on the highway, and chances are, you're going to get overwhelmed, and you'll end up in an accident. So a road test is a blessing, because it shows the truth. It separates what you know from what you don't know. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us, it's a way of assessing ourselves. It's a way we measure ourselves with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because all of us say we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of us say La ilaha illallah. All of us say Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. But how much do we really have it in our hearts? And with every test, we understand exactly where we stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's a blessing. Every time we go through a test, every time we are faced with a different test, according to our reaction, according to our behavior, we can assess for ourselves, how close am I to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How loyal am I to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How committed am I to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That this difficulty that is in front of me right now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells me to do one thing, but my desires tell me to do the exact opposite. If I follow my desires, then this is a proof that my love, my commitment, my dedication, my belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala isn't strong enough to behave the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded me to. But if we do follow the command of Allah, then we can reassure ourselves and we can be happy over the fact that alhamdulillah, my love, my commitment, my dedication for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is strong enough to push me away from what is haram, to push me away from what is forbidden. So in reality, a test is a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it shows us our true nature. That when we say La ilaha illallah, is this La ilaha illallah, is this verbal testification hollow, or is it a true, sincere testification that we truly believe and we truly dedicate and we have truly committed ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the first reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us. The second reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Ibrahim and tests us, and this is indicated in this ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses very precise and exact words in this ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذِ بِتَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ. His Rabb tested him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have used a different word. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have said, خَالِقُهُ, his creator tested him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have said, رَازِقُهُ, his sustainer, his provider tested him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have said, مَالِكُهُ, his master, his owner tested him. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have said, إِذِ بِتَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمَ اللَّهُ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Ibrahim. Or it could have been, إِذِ بِتَلَىٰ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ, that Allah tested Ibrahim alayhi salam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to use this word Rabb, that his Rabb tested Ibrahim alayhi salam. The Rabb of Ibrahim tested Ibrahim alayhi salam. And there's a very subtle indication in these words. As many of us will know, that the word Rabb cannot be translated or defined by one word. Sometimes we open the translation of the Quran and we see that the word Rabb, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, has been translated as the Rabb or the God of the universe. But that's a very insufficient, inadequate meaning, inadequate definition of the word Rabb. Rab, the complete entire definition of the word Rab, is someone who brings something into existence out of nothing. And not only does he bring it into existence, but he sustains it, he provides for it, and he takes care of it to the extent that now it is fully developed and capable of taking care of its own, itself. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Rabb of everything we see around us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Rabb of the universe, of the worlds, it means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought everything into existence out of nothing. Meaning there was no need for raw material. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was the originator of the raw material. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought everything into being. And after putting into everything into existence, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not just throw it and leave it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala aided and assisted and sustained everything at every juncture of its way. Every time something needed to be developed, every time something needed to be taken care of, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took care of that. So the point of this ayah, the second reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Ibrahim alayhi salam, is to develop and nurture Ibrahim alayhi salam, is to develop his character, his attitude, so that Ibrahim alayhi salam could withstand and face the trials that he was to face as a prophet. So that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could develop him and nurture him so that he can actually handle the responsibility of being a prophet. And understand it as such even for us, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts us through different trials, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually developing our character, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually developing our attitudes. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is molding us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taking care of us for a eventual objective. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be patient, that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts us through difficulties so we learn patience. Because reading about patience is not enough. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a very annoying child. And we have to deal with this child. And we slowly become more patient. We learn patience. And instead of just reading about patience, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has practically taught us patience. So these are the reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us. To mold us, to make us into something that we need to be. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Ibrahim alayhi salam, to mold him into the prophet, to mold him into the Khalil that he was. The reason why Ibrahim alayhi salam became the close friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Ibrahim alayhi salam accepted all these tests. Ibrahim alayhi salam accepted this, and Ibrahim alayhi salam fulfilled all these obligations. Whenever a command was given to Ibrahim alayhi salam, whenever some difficulty was faced, whenever he faced a difficulty, Ibrahim alayhi salam accepted it and he fulfilled it. He gave preference to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over himself. He gave preference to the command and the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over the love of his desires. So this was the reason that Ibrahim alayhi salam became the Khalil. And then going on with the ayah, as we mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Ibrahim with bikalimat, that's what it says, with a number of words. What does this exactly mean? In short, what this means is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Ibrahim alayhi salam with different obligations and different prohibitions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Ibrahim, you have to do all these things and you have to stay away from these other things. And Ibrahim alayhi salam obliged. He said, okay, I'll do these things and I'll stay away from these things. And the second meaning is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him through different afflictions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him through different hardships to see whether or not Ibrahim alayhi salam would be the type to give in and turn around and go to someone else, or would he be strong enough to stay by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Would he have that patience, that resilience to stand by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and keep his sight in the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, keep his attention and focus on the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Ibrahim alayhi salam with. And we know that Ibrahim alayhi salam went through many difficulties. He had to, what the greatest was that he had to sacrifice his child. There were other incidents when Ibrahim alayhi salam was thrown into the fire. There were other incidents where Ibrahim alayhi salam had to confront his people and inform them that he had to do his obligation as a prophet. So these were the different things through which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he says that Islam is made up of 30 parts. Islam is comprised of 30 parts. And each one of these parts are things which Ibrahim alayhi salam was tested. In other words, each one of these parts, each one of these 30 parts was an obligation on Ibrahim alayhi salam. And each one of these 30 things, Ibrahim alayhi salam perfected and he completed. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Wa Ibrahim alladhi waffa." That Ibrahim alayhi salam not only completed, but he fulfilled to the satisfied requirement that was required. So what are these 30 things? We won't go over all these 30 things, we'll just go over 10 of the 30 things. The first 10 are mentioned in Surah Tawbah, the second 10 are mentioned in Surah Mu'minun, and the last 10 are mentioned in Surah Al-Ahzab. In Surah Tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "At-ta'ibun, al-'abidun, al-hamidun, as-sa'ihun, al-raki'un, as-sajidun, al-amiruna bil-ma'ruf, wan-nahuna 'anil munkar, wal-hafidun li hududillah." These are the first 10 things with which Ibrahim alayhi salam was tested, and these are the first 10 things that make up the 30 parts of Islam, according to Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. So what are these 10 things? At-ta'ibun. That a person, in order to be a true Muslim, he has to be someone who is always making tawbah, who is always returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is always seeking the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second is al-abidun. This person is always worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is always in a state of remembrance. He is always in a state of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this word worship is very misleading, because in English, the word worship gives us an idea of some sort of ritual or some sort of rite. That when you're praying, that's worship. But when you're spending time with your family, that's not worship. That's a worldly aspect of your life. But in Islam, a worship, an act of worship, is anything you do for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whether it's eating, whether it's spending time with your family, if this is done for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this too is considered worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for Muslims, we have it very easy, that every single aspect of our lives, every single second of our lives can be devoted to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the second part with which Islam is made of, al-abidun, to be a constant worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third is al-hamidun. The person is always praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever happens, whatever success in life, he is always giving the credit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is being humble. He's humbling himself. He's saying, this accomplishment is not because I worked hard. It may be a result, but the deeper meaning is that it is only the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's only the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is only the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that allowed me to work hard. So he is constantly giving the credit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is never being arrogant about himself. He's not saying, he or she is not saying, look at all this that I've done, it's all because of me. Rather, it's because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The person is humble. He's always giving the credit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fourth thing is as-sa'ihun. As-sa'ihun means as-sa'imun, meaning a person who is fasting. And fasting is also a form of worship. But the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights fasting is because fasting is a very fundamental form of worship. It's one of the greatest ways of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not only worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the heart and mind, but also physically. That now you're giving up your basic necessities in order to live for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're not just sacrificing your time, you're not just sacrificing your money, not your family, but everything you need to survive, water and food. This is the essential of what we need to survive. But even these things we're willing to forego for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the next quality, the next part is ar-raki'un. People who bow, people who do ruku' to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next is as-sajidun, people who do sajda, people who prostrate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now these are both parts of salah. So we can just consider that to be people who constantly pray their salah. This is another form of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next part is al-amiruna bil ma'ruf. That they command to do good. They teach people what is good. They teach people what is right. They're not people who cause havoc. They're not people who go around causing trouble. Instead, they're the opposite. Not only do they do good, but when they see others doing something incorrect, when they see others doing something wrong, they go and they try to correct it to the best of their abilities. Brothers and sisters, can you please just move up? Jazakallah khair. The next quality, the next part is وَالنَّاهُونَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, that they prevent from what is considered evil. Ma'ruf and munkar, these are very interesting words. Ma'ruf means something which is according to custom, something which is customary, meaning something which is known to be good. Munkar, on the other hand, is something which is strange. In other words, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying is that evil is something which is meant to be strange. Evil is something that we're supposed to stay away from. Whereas good is something we're supposed to be constantly accustomed with. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the next ayah it says, in the next part of the ayah it says, وَالنَّاهُونَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, that they forbid people, they help people stay away from that which is evil. And finally, وَالْحَافِظُونَ لِحُدُودِ اللَّهِ, and they themselves ensure that they are not going against the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the first 10 parts that make up Islam. There's 20 others, but for each one, as Ibn Abbas says, that Ibrahim alayhis salam not only fulfilled each one of these 10 commandments, but Ibrahim alayhis salam did an excellent job. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewarded him by saying, "Wa Ibrahim alladhi waffa," that Ibrahim alayhis salam completely fulfilled and satisfied all the requirements that were needed and necessary for these obligations. Now, the reason I brought these points up is for us to understand that we don't need to remember these 30 points or these 10 points. Because the basis of these 10 points, the basis of all these 30 points are just 2 points. If we have these 2 qualities in us, then these 30 points will come by itself. So this is the main thing, that if you have these 2 qualities, if you can develop these 2 qualities in you, then you'll have these 30 things. And as Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu says, that Islam is made up of these 30 things. Meaning if a person can master these 30 things, if a person can live according to these 30 things, then he is a true Muslim. And the reduction of all that is just 2 things. And the basis is just 2 things. The first is yaqeen. Having complete reliance and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the first thing. And the second is as-sabr, which is patience in Allah, patience. Yaqeen refers to having, first and foremost, believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, understanding that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is true, and believing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always there to assist us, and we rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala solely. Meaning we do not worship anything else, we do not turn to anything else for assistance, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second part is as-sabr, which is patience. And sabr is of 3 types. Sabr, the first type of sabr is as-sabr ala ta'at, which is being patient in doing the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning sometimes it becomes very difficult for us to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but despite that we are patient and we continue to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second is as-sabr anil ma'asiyah, which is to be patient in staying away from the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because sometimes it becomes very difficult for us to stay away from those things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited. But we remain patient and we work hard and we stay away from that. And finally, the third type of sabr is as-sabr ala al-bala, which is being patient on afflictions and hardships. Whenever something difficult is happening, we remain patient and we focus on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we don't complain. Rather, we say this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala developing us, as we mentioned. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala molding us into something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be. So these 2 qualities are the essential qualities of every believer. And again, as we mentioned, that when we are tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's a blessing. That it allows us to see whether or not we are true Muslims. So whenever we are tested, if we see that we are missing these 2 qualities, this quality of yaqeen and this quality of sabr, then we should understand that we have to work on our iman, we have to develop our iman, and we have to become better Muslims. We have to become better servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to become much more submissive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'll finish off with the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam. That Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he was thrown into the fire, and this fire was extremely hot, when he was thrown into the fire, Jibreel alayhi salam came to Ibrahim alayhi salam, and he asked him that, Ibrahim, do you need any help? So imagine, you know, this man is thrown into the fire, and this is the only sort of assistance. Jibreel alayhi salam comes, and this is the only thing, living thing that's around him. And Jibreel alayhi salam says, do you need any help? And just ponder over what Ibrahim alayhi salam says. He says, as for you, I don't need any help from you. But for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already knows my condition, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't have to ask me. Meaning, his yaqeen, his conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was so strong that even when Jibreel alayhi salam came, he said, I don't need your help. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of me. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already knows. I don't even have to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save me because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already knows. This was the level of devotion, this was the level of yaqeen, this was the level of conviction and faith that Ibrahim alayhi salam had. And this is the level of yaqeen that we have to try to achieve. And again, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at the results. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at the effort and the energy that we put behind this. It may be such that we never get to the level of Ibrahim alayhi salam. It may be such that we never get up to the level of even being called or considered someone who is a good Muslim. But as long as we are constantly trying, as long as we are genuine and sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is all Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cares about. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just looks at how much you have tried. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at the results. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to know how much you've tried. And for every time you try, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you. And that is the difference between this world and the hereafter. That in this world you can try and try and try, but if you don't have the results, no one will accept it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His mercy, He is not worried about the results. He's worried about how much effort you've put in. So keep on trying, brothers and sisters, keep on trying. Try and try. Put that energy, put that effort. And this is what is needed. Don't worry about the results. The results will come. But it starts off with our effort. If we are not willing to make sincere, genuine effort, then the result will never be there. If we're constantly saying, I'm not getting any results, it's because we're not making the effort. And even if the results don't come, don't worry about that. You know, a person can try their best. A person can work very hard in trying to memorize the Quran. But he passes away. He or she doesn't get a chance to memorize the Quran. Not even a third of the Quran. But they had that intention. And they made a lot of effort. They had that sincere devotion. And on the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward that person accordingly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to say, you have only managed to do this much, so I'll just give you this much. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at the intention of the person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at how much effort that person put in. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward that person accordingly. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to understand all this. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to make that effort in order to try and become like the Anbiya alayhi salam, to try and become like Ibrahim alayhi salam, try and become like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put it in us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a tawfiq. Barakallahu lana wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Majeed wa nafa'ana wa iyaakum bil ayati wa dhikri al-Hakim. Astaghfirullah li wa lakum risa'il al-Muslimin. Fastaghfiru innahu huwa al-Ghafuru rahim. الحمد لله الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك وصل على المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات وبارك على محمد وأزواجه وذريته. قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام: أرحم أمتي بأمتي أبو بكر، وأشدهم في أمر الله تعالى عمر، وأصدقهم حياء عثمان، وأقضاهم علي، وفاطمة سيدة نساء أهل الجنة، والحسن والحسين سيدا شباب أهل الجنة، وحمسة أسد الله وأسد رسوله رضوان الله تعالى عليهم أجمعين. Respected brothers and sisters, I'll finish off with something very interesting. That in this ayah that we just covered, it says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Ibrahim alayhi salam. And as many of us may know, that the Quran can be read in different dialects. The Quran can be read in different modes. That the Quran can be read in different ways. Just to give you an example, that in Surah Al-Fatiha, instead of saying Maliki Yawmiddin, another way that you can read is Maliki Yawmiddin. And it has the same meaning. That Malik and Malik is pretty much the same thing. Right? There are, these different ways of reading are all established from Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and these are just different dialects. Just like how in English, we speak English, but if you go to Australia, they speak English also, but their English is very different. But still English. Right? So likewise, this is just the way you can understand that the Quran is in Arabic, but there are different dialects of Arabic, and therefore there are different ways of reading the Quran. And one way of reading this ayah, and this is mentioned in the tafsir of Imam Zamakhshari in Kashaf, he says the way Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu and Imam Abu Hanifa would read this ayah is wa idh ibtala ibrahimu rabbahu. That remember the time or recall the time when Ibrahim tested his Lord. When Ibrahim tested Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. بِكَلِمَاتٍ فَأَتَمَّهُنْ. So what does this mean? What does it mean that Ibrahim alayhi salam tested Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And in the tafsir it says that Ibrahim alayhi salam made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he wanted to see if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would accept his du'as. This is how Ibrahim tested Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He wanted to see if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would accept his du'a. And this is how we need to test Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. We need to make du'a to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to see if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts our du'a. But understand that if you are not in terms with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to begin with, then you cannot test Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you are disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you are going against the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you cannot expect to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you everything you wish for. Right? In the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it says that a person who consumes haram, a person who is involved in a haram lifestyle, his clothing is from haram sources, his food and drink is from haram sources, this person makes dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but his du'as are not accepted. Because everything he owns is from a haram source, is from a haram income. Right? So if you are not in terms with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you are not eligible to quote unquote test Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to first come into terms with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once you have fulfilled the obligation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then make dua and then test Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and see whether or not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts your du'as. And as we see that Ibrahim alayhi salam makes the du'as and Ibrahim alayhi salam's du'as are accepted. In other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilled the satisfaction of Ibrahim alayhi salam. That Ibrahim alayhi salam, and this is mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah as well, that Ibrahim alayhi salam said, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I want to see a miracle. You know, just to comfort my heart. It's not that I don't believe in you. So Ibrahim alayhi salam wanted this to just comfort his heart. So obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you will see that whatever you make dua for will be accepted. You will be given what you want. But again, the condition is that you are in terms with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you are disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you are involved in things which nullify your dua, then don't expect your du'as to be accepted and don't say things like, I make dua and my dua is not being accepted. You were never in terms to begin with. You know, so this is what we have to work for. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it very clearly. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. That I accept the dua of my servants only when they make dua to me. In other words, if we don't make dua, then our du'as will not be accepted. This is the first thing. We need to learn to make du'a. And the second thing is that We have to come to terms with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if we want our du'as to be accepted. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to practice on this. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to understand this. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us people who have come to terms with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us people who are constantly in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make us people who follow in the footsteps of Ibrahim alayhi salam, following the footsteps of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inna Allah ya'muru bil adli wal ihsan wa ita'i dhil qurba wa yanha 'anil fahsha'i wal munkari wal baghi ya'idhukum la'allakum tadhakkarun. Fadhkuru Allah yadhkurukum washkuruhu wa la takfurun. Aqimus salah.